about taxes.
I'm glad I get to. All right, no,
Third
was me, like about to. It would end with me in a tri-corner hat and a fife.
moving on to Alex Jones's acreage up the road.
It would just end with me, you know, using the term as the framers intended.
Well, I hope you're satisfied for obeying the letter of the law, if not the spirit.
Yeah, I don't know what it is about the Austin TSA, man. Like, that has brought out the worst in both of us.
Yeah, man, you and me both. It did it in front of my kids, which was embarrassing because it's always a thing, right? It's like, you know, look, we're going to take the pat down. And then they always love to act surprised that it takes 15 minutes to get around to doing the pat down. And then meanwhile, my stuff has gone through and it's unsupervised for vast amounts of time. And so somebody says, I asked, hey, what can I do to prevent that? Because that's really awkward to be away from all my stuff. And they say, oh, just ask us. You know, when you opt out, say, hey, do you mind if I stay with my stuff? And then, so I did that the next time. This was the next time with all my kids and family. And I was like, hey, we're going to opt out. Is it okay if we stay with our stuff? I guess I caught someone on a weird day, but she's just like, what? You don't like metal detectors? You just don't want to walk through that metal detector right there? And I guess it was a deal that since we had kids, they weren't going to make us do the thing or whatever. And then, I don't know, they were just aggressive and I was aggressive back because it's like, I've had it. It's like, I'm trying to play your stupid games.
Why don't you like metal detectors?
I love metal detectors. Detecting metals is the jam. I think I'm going to buy a MacBook.
Do you go for the pat down in pre? If you get TSA pre, or do you get TSA?
I don't get pre anymore, and I found out why is because that is a decision that that Southwest does to they pay for pre, yeah. And they pay for that for their premium customers, just to be all like, you love us, we love you, and I guess I'm not flying enough Southwest that they just stop paying. So now I've got to go apply and do a whole thing, but their effing online system is so Byzantine. I mean, I've actually tried twice to go through the whole thing and just couldn't.
Global entry, right?
Well, I was trying to do global entry or just the TSA thing or literally any goddamn thing, but it's like
Do global entry because global entry gets you TSA, but they'll never.
Great club in South Beach if you're into that kind of thing, too.
There's what?
Global entry is a great club in South Beach if you're into that kind of thing, too.
Oh, man, you're getting me all upset. Well, and it's doubly weird because, you know, this is all happening as I'm flying less and less. So it makes it hard, less of a top priority.
You want to know what? You think that, but the sting is all
just
the more.
Every time. Saving yourself days of rage.
Like at some point, you get into the same traffic jam going into work every day. You just kind of factor it into part of your day.
Sure.
There's a certain amount of airport harassment for which you just take as, you know, you charge it to the game if you're a regular business traveler.
Mm-hmm.
Every once in a while, you have those same instincts of a business traveler where you're getting there exactly when you need to because you know exactly how the system works. It is all the more frustrating. Anyway.
Andrew, can we...
In other news, I enjoy... plenty of things that the government provides. It's not just things that I don't like, you know, tax collection and the TSA. There's plenty of things.
Hey, we starting now, I guess we have to start plugging the hat party, right?
Yep. hat.t2t2.eu. I'll remind you guys about it.
Bryce, you were cut off. What were you going to say?
Can you test your audio for me, Andrew?
Hi, this is Andrew, and this is my audio. It's me talking.
It sounds like a room mic. Is it?
I'm on my iPad.
That would explain it. Right on.
Yes. I can move it closer, but you might have to recenter me. Is this better?
It's pretty samey. Yeah, I don't think it's much different. It's probably better if you just center up, if you can, on your camera.
Tilting the iPad. Save.
Yeah,
okay.
There we go. Okay, that'll work. Justin, can you give us some audio?
By the way...
Check, check, check. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. This is about how I'm going to talk throughout the thing. Hello. Doodly-doo.
Coming a little hot. Okay. That'll work. What were you going to say, Brian?
Man, political parties are a difficult situation to work with, because I was thinking about how you know, what a good friend of, you know, of us personally and our network and everything, my so-called 8-bit life is. But then I saw I saw Roberto talking about, you know, drumming up nominations to get him on for the podcast awards, and it's weird because I'm like, but the party already held their primaries. There's nothing I can do for you, and I felt bound and stuff. It was, I don't know, it was very weird.
Hey, people's choice is open.
Hey, is this better? I have to. Peter Wax is taking a call, but he was going to join me at some point, so I'll have to pull this out. But does this sound better?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah.
Okay.
An open convention.
All right. Well, we're ready if you guys are.
I'm already.
All right.
Let's go.
Take it away in 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
That's a fact. Like Agnes, Agatha, Jermaine, and Jack.
And Justin Robert Young.
Hey, it's me, Justin.
Well, I'm going to just give a shameless plug right off the top of the show, because there are only 3 days left. I'm part of a Humble Bundle with Kevin J. Anderson and some other great authors. If you go to humblebundle.com, click on the Wordfire Sci-Fi Specials. If you get this thing like Wednesday, you can check, but I think it'll be gone. But if you're watching or listening right now or the next day or two, check it out. Name your price. Got some great books, including free previously unpublished Frank Herbert novels. That's right. The guy who wrote Dune. These books were considered a little bit too weird for their time, but right now would probably be perfect. Also included in there is we've got an Alan Dean Foster story. There's my stuff and other collection of great authors. So check that out at humblebundle.com. None of these proceeds will benefit the show Weird Things at all, but they will help the Challenger Space Science Center for Space Education, which helps kids learn about space and science, and the Science Fiction Fantasy Writers Association, and they've got a Givers Fund, which helps out really important causes in science fiction. So check that out. That is the Humble Bundle Sci-Fi Specials, and it's going to be gone soon. Now's the chance. Now's your chance. Like, name your price. You could go in there, put in $5 and get the first tier. I think pay like 15 and you get 18 books, actually 22 books, 22 ebooks for one super low price.
I went in for $25 and it was a great decision. What a wealth, a treasure trove of awesome books.
I'm going to
thank you for your support.
You're going to have to cover me as I do the 25 tier. Actually, I'm going to do 26.
Humble Bundle. So here's a fun fact on Boing Boing. Kevin J. Anderson had an article up explaining the fact that given the number that we sold in the first week, all of the authors in there would classify as bestsellers, you know, because having sold several thousand. But because of the way bestsellers are counted, it doesn't count. But it is sort of the weird economics that we live in. But bundles are a great way to you find a couple things you like and help out some authors and help out some great causes.
Awesome possum, man. No, everybody, go ahead and grab the Humble Bundle when you can. Only 3 days left. This is not something that's going to be there forever. No. Don't walk.
Exactly. It has been an exciting week. Let me tell you guys, I'm going to remind you of an episode we had a few months back, where I breathlessly described this really cool presentation that a NASA scientist by the name of Phil Lubin did, explaining his ambitious idea for sending a space probe to another star system, the Alpha Centauri, using light propulsion, laser propulsion, where you would have a bank of lasers on the ground in an array that could project a beam thousands of miles out and accelerate something, let's say a meter wide sail to 30% the speed of light, where it could reach our next nearest star in 15 years, which means, you know, from within our own lifetime, we could be sending probes around another star. Crazy, but feasible. And he had an entire, like, you know, 60-page research paper explaining this. This isn't some, oh, and then we get dark matter here or exotic matter here. It's not some Alcubierre drive or even
some theoretical one day when we have fusion kind of thing, which I think will happen. This is all real tech right now. You could buy off the shelf. You just have to scale it up and solve some engineering problems, but it's not a far-fetched thing. But anyhow, we talked about this and how exciting that would be and how that could scale to actually sending larger probes. You could put a payload, like a 1 kilo payload on Mars in 30 minutes. You could actually send a human spacecraft to Mars in a couple of days using this technology. Well, there was an announcement this week. Billionaire Yuri Milner, who had previously put some money into SETI, along with advisors including Stephen Hawking and Zuckerberg, has announced this Project Starshot, which is the plan to send exactly what Lubin described, a probe. And Lubin is on board the advisory group here to send a probe to Alpha Centauri. He's putting $100 million in to get this thing going. It's still going to take more money and resources to make this thing happen, but this has become a real thing. And exciting to see something that Lubin was talking about, you know, a few months ago, that you can actually still find his NASA presentation, and to see this thing happening. Of course, you know, of course, a little bit weird. People are like, oh, Stephen Hawking's plan for this. I love Stephen Hawking, but it's not Stephen Hawking's plan. This is largely, sure, sure, to my understanding.
But I mean, that's one of those things where it's like Stephen Hawking knows and Yuri Milner knows that that attaching Stephen Hawking, like, that's why everyone's calling it Stephen Hawking's, you know, plan is extreme value to his participation.
Yes. It doesn't make that it's true, but yes, that is correct. It's why you bring his name in there and Zuckerberg in there, is because they will get attention to it. And Lubin is part of this, and that's what's critical important is this is, and other people talk about that, but he was, as far as I know, the guy that really pushes forward. But to me, it's just rooting for the guys, the women who do the real, who kind of do the work and have the vision. You kind of want to see them get recognition and not just the bigger name, you know, get like, oh, you know, so-and-so's, like, well, that's the person you know, and so you say that it's them. But it's great that Stephen Hawking is helping support this and lending his name to it. That's fantastic.
So I'm certain. Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
So I mean, yeah, and obviously the machinations of this continuing to get money and public support and press that keeps the project going is critical. But, you know, also so is giving credit to the people that are actually getting it started. I'm curious though, as to how much the success of SpaceX and Blue Origin, specifically when it comes to the press, really affects an announcement like this, because I certainly can envision a world not that long ago where an announcement like this is made. It kind of makes some waves in certain niche press, but it's not necessarily a gigantic worldwide story like I think this one wound up unfolding to be. And part of it, at least in my brain, thinks that is due to the fact that you have these companies that are actually going to space on technology and demonstrating engineering feats that we had thought were decades far away and now are here. Do you think that factors into our excitement for things like this?
I think yes, that I think that the idea that we, now that we're a week after, we have a SpaceX thing land on a drone ship, what's been going on with Bezos and Blue Origin, absolutely helps. Maybe you're right, but I mean, I'm scared to think that, you know, the plan to send a probe to our nearest star system isn't world-worthy news outside of
that. It's not that the idea will always get interest, right? It's that now these things happen, and it's not just a press release you read about once and then you never hear about.
Well, okay, so I guess here's the thought experiment that leads me to, unfortunately, I think I disagree, because if $100 million was committed in 1991, before there was any kind of commercial spaceflight happening, then I think it still would make, and in fact, with Stephen Hawking, if Stephen Hawking and somebody with $1 billion or more committed $100 million to a project that was going to, you know, be an interstellar probe, I'd like to think it would still generate just as much interest. I'd like to think that it's not just because, I mean, as thrilled as I am with SpaceX doing well and Blue Origin having success, I don't know that that's quite the. I think it's largely the scale of the amount of money being committed and this, and the nature of the kind of outrageous technology. Which, by the way, I'm certain we've talked about what the mechanics are of this. But could you walk us through that again, as best as you understand them, Andrew?
Okay, so this, what made this possible, has been recent developments in laser technology. And the idea is that if you have a laser beam and you hit it against an object, those photons actually have velocity and they impart some kinetic energy onto whatever they hit. It's a very tiny amount, but when they hit an object, they impart that on it. And if you have an extremely powerful laser system hitting an object, it will push that. And if that object is in space and your lasers are in space, or in this case on the ground, and you're putting out, let's say, 100 gigawatts of energy, which is the same amount of energy pretty much given off by the space shuttle when it launches, instead of a spacecraft that has to carry all of its fuel and move the fuel as it's going along, you're only moving your payload. In this case, would be just a microchip with a microsatellite on it and a meter-wide sail, a little target for the lasers to hit. So the lasers hit this thing with 100 gigawatts of energy and push it for 20 minutes. And at the end of 20 minutes, it's going one-third the speed of light. Now, the problem with rockets is you're not only trying to move the rocket, you're trying to move your fuel and everything else. But here, you put all of your energy into a laser beam so it doesn't have to carry the fuel, and it's just pure energy is moving this.
So I guess if we're going to take this to its logical conclusion, let's say, 300 years in the future, our solar system is just covered in an array of these energy relay stations, these stuff that can shoot light and send stuff ping-ponging around, right? So you have essentially something that's largely a sail and a bit of a payload. Let's say it's a Elon Musk. The rocket, you get to orbit fairly cheaply using your reusable, Falcon, whatever. And then an array of satellites do 1G, or maybe a little bit more if you're in a hurry, of pushing you out towards Mars. And then at some point, the Venus relay has a better angle on it, and it starts pushing you on a corrected orbit. And then at some point, 2 days into it, the Jupiter station, the asteroid belt relay array starts slowing you down to the tune of 1G the entire time, and then you slow down, and then you're in orbit around Mars.
In the broad strokes, absolutely, that's what's exciting. And why not this century? The idea that you could have several of these systems around Earth orbit, and then actually put one around Mars orbit, because the problem is your lasers are only going to be effective for
one direction, 20, 000, one vector,
yeah, or 20,000 miles, and so you're the one being shooting at you from Jupiter is not going to have much effect, but you would actually, you want to have, need to have one to slow you down because you're going really, really fast. But yeah, I'm all for that. I think we build an interplanetary subway system of these massive light propulsion arrays.
I guess would it be a silly? It is a silly metaphor, but if you want to understand how this would work, picture the three of us. Blowing on a feather, right? Like Andrew blows on it, and he's trying to get it past me to Bryce, and about halfway through, Justin blows on it, and it gets closer. Now I got to slow it down, so I blow it to slow it down, and then it lands right in Bryce's open palm.
Better to just have only, it's a weird analogy. And it'd be only probably, you'd have one at the place you're leaving and one at the place you're arriving, because the lasers aren't going to be very, a laser around Jupiter won't help you if you're trying to get to Mars. And you're coming from Earth. Well,
okay. So if you had one, I guess what I worry about, and tell me if I'm wrong about this. Like when you fire something off from Earth with the intention of getting it to Mars, you have to factor in the fact that everything's orbiting. So you may fire in the wrong or in a strange direction. That is the, let's say, the opposite side of the solar system from where Mars is.
But well, your transit time's 3 days.
Right, it seems to me like having only two directional vectors, one at the origin point and the other at the destination point, it doesn't seem like that would be enough to guide you all the way there. I may be wrong. This may be something we should lean over on Tensor Guy in the chat or something.
Or I could answer if you want, but having read the paper.
Sorry, go ahead.
And having, my own thoughts on this, you would have a wildly elliptical orbit around Mars to do that. You could have a much farther, so you would have a Mars station that would be out there further out to try to hit this at. And so that's your point. It's you understand, the effective range of these lasers is several thousand miles. You're beyond that, you're 20,000 miles or so. So you need to put it around an asteroid or in orbit around the area you're trying to go to.
Got it. What you're saying is the gravitational wells provide the corrective vectors that get you looping around.
If you're trying to shoot a laser from Jupiter, by the time it hits your object heading towards Mars, the size of your beam is going to be larger than the moon, and you're not going to impart any energy onto the object.
Sure. Okay. All right. Wow. So I guess, just the beginning and end point.
Yeah. You could do relays in between. You could put different stations and orbit around the sun. You could have several stations then there and build sort of a railroad effect.
In the case of the interstellar probe, of course, there's no stop vector, right? Everything has to just be, it would have to be just a flyby of Alpha Centauri.
Yeah, it would be a flyby. We'd be sending tons of these probes. We'd be sending a number of these probes towards there. You could continuously be dropping these, every 20 minutes or so, and keep it going.
So I guess that's my question. What is the cost per launch on something like this? Because that's something that we talk a lot about, especially when it comes to private space flight, is how cheaply it can be done compared to how we've done it in the past. This, I imagine, would be a tremendous amount cheaper than, a dirty old rocket.
So your cost is you're going to be launching these from space. So you'd have your payloads already up there. Each one of these things weighs grams, and it would be a cost, they say, of like the cost of an iPhone. That's what your cost is for these things.
Now, how do you get the signal back on the cheap? Because by the time it gets to Alpha Centauri, I got to imagine there's an awful lot of interference. There's a lot of awful lot of other noise happening. Do you think? You probably have read about this too.
Yeah, you're using lasers. You're going to be using lasers to shoot your stuff back. There's. I refer you again to the paper, which I had a back and forth with Tensor guy about this.
I read the paper, but let's just pretend that I'm guessing Justin probably didn't read the paper.
I've yet to publish my critique, so talk about it publicly.
Let's pretend Bryce hasn't read the paper, and let's dumb it down for Bryce.
You're using lasers, guys. You're using lasers for directed back. Instead of like when we're trying to talk to Voyager and other space probes, you're using, you're sending radio waves that go back everywhere. You're using line of sight directed lasers shooting back at Earth. And so there's an entire section that goes into that. So that's one of the things exciting about this is that the hard parts have been, will this work, whatever. And we still have to figure out, like, there's interplanetary dust, there's interstellar dust, there's galactic levels of dust, all these other things you have to factor in to figure out, what are your impact? There's the difference between if your wafer is going edge on towards the direction it's going or if it's straight on towards where it's going. And if it's straight on, you're going to get far more impacts from debris versus if it's on edge. So it's not from an engineering point of view, it's not a settled thing. There are thousands of questions we have to solve and figure out, and that's part of what Milner's $100 billion is going towards, is how do we figure this stuff out?
Sure. But just in that kind of broad strokes way, in my mind, a star is putting out so much radiation in so many different parts of the spectrum that it just seems like a gram-sized, we're running on a lithium ion battery or nuclear fusion. I don't know what it would be, but it just seems like the ability to beam an image that we could read and translate into a signal on the other side of, 2.5 light years or whatever the distance is, just seems extraordinary. And I guess the first thing that pops in is based on the type of star that you're sending it to, you would just broadcast on the parts of the spectrum that star doesn't have a lot of noise.
You're when you're using a laser, you're going to be at one far end of a spectrum that you're not going to really necessarily worry about the interference like that, and you have a very specific idea of what part of the sky that it's in. You sent this thing on a trajectory, so you have an idea roughly where it is. You could be, and if you're sending a lot of these probes, is you can build sort of a mini array that can communicate backwards. And one of the things Lupin talked about was the idea of we could send one probe towards every degree of the sky in a year just by constantly popping these things out.
Man, that's extraordinary. Like, that would be pretty much year zero, the day that the organism of planet Earth suddenly expanded its perception throughout the universe, right? Like that's the beginning of when we see everything around us. I don't know, that's extraordinary.
Yeah, I mean, this probe would have a 2 megapixel camera on it, and it's doing flybys towards there, and we can see what's there. And, we could do fly through the solar system there, if there is a solar system, if there are planets, and see what's there, and then we can send stuff. You know, we would get our data back in 4 years, 5 years, 4.5 years, and we know, oh, okay, let's send our next one there, and 20 years later, we can get really accurate data. So, well, I mean,
and I guess you would probably do a cloud of them and have them arrive at different times, so maybe the first one, you have to make an important decision where it's like, okay, there are three planets that which one do you want to fly by, because you can only fly by one, and you got to decide how close you want to fly by. And it's like, okay, now – but you probably wouldn't even have time to get message, because your decisions would take 2 years or however long. How far away is Alpha Centauri? 2 or 3 years?
4.5 light years.
4.5 light years? Right. So it's like the very commands would take a while. There was one program. It was a bit sensationalist. It was like 10 years ago. It was talking about, you know, I think it was like Walking with Aliens or something like that. It was in the vein of Walking with Dinosaurs. But there was one metaphor that I thought was very, very good, that for humanity, the experience of watching a space probe land or arrive on another planet, on another star system, would be like standing in the very back row and watching your child do a spelling bee, in that you hoped very much that you trained that child well, but there was absolutely nothing you could do to affect the outcome. And you just had to hope that the artificial intelligence that you created made the kind of decisions that you wanted to get the kind of data that you need out of this. Because it's going to be not in your lifetime will you have the chance to see your next attempt.
There's what's exciting about what we're doing with our next Mars rover is that it's going to be semi-autonomous. It's going to be able to drive itself around Mars so that we don't have to be on the joystick all the time, planning 5 days in advance, you know, on plotting paper where to let it go and do that. And yeah, I think that, you know, what's exciting for me is that within our lifetime, we could be sending probes to star systems, which was for all intents and purposes, a year or so ago, if you hadn't, you know, read Lubin's paper, we're talking hundreds of years. The idea that we could do this within this short amount of time, combining the fact that we can now make probes extremely small and the size of a microchip, and two, the developments and what's fueled the development in lasers that made this possible has been a lot of the driving forces in fiber optics. And we've increased. You need to have certain materials with high indices of refractivity, because part of the problem is if you're hitting 100 gigawatts at something the size of your kitchen table, it should melt. But if you're able to make a mirror, which we can now with 99.999% ability to reflect, the amount of heat that it absorbs won't melt it. And so there's been all these recent developments now that just, it's a game changer. And Brian, what you just sort of intuited the idea of, what if we put these all over the solar system and we're going around? That might be the be-all best way for us to get around. And in the paper, he gets into explaining why this is probably still going to be more efficient than using antimatter propulsion and in the difficulties of that, besides the fact we don't have antimatter. Although there is an antimatter startup called I think Positron Dynamics, which is funded by Peter Thiel, which they have plans to increase the production of antimatter and containment, and they're talking about making rocket ships and all sorts of stuff that are antimatter driven. And this is like, these are real people.
So what I love about this development and this idea, and just to, I don't know, go on a brief side jag about this idea of having an array of different things pushing stuff around, is in Physics of the Impossible by Michio Kaku, he talks about stuff like, and we've talked about this before, I apologize if it's familiar to some of the listeners, but he talks about the idea of moving an object with your mind. Yeah, it's like, look, telekinesis is not real, but let's say we wanted to create the feeling of telekinesis. Well, we can, you know, scan brains. We can figure out what people are concentrating on. We can tell, and there, you know, there's technology that quadriplegics are able to move cursors by thinking about certain things. Separately, you know, we've got wires and strings and magnets and stuff that could do stuff all around. So he posited that, you know, a room in which everything was very precisely arranged and stuff in very specific ways. But you were left with the ability to walk into this room, and as long as you were in this room and you were the tuned in host of it, you could think of an object and move it with your mind. You could do essentially, you know, the stereotypical, you know, TK stuff. It seems like what we want is the ability to hop in our spaceship, treat it like a car, and just drive from point A to point B. And it seems like in a similar vein, we can do this to our universe by creating a ray of lasers that push us very, very quickly from point A to point B.
Think about, let's go towards the latter part of this of the century and imagine a world where we take what we have now and we extrapolate it. You're sitting there and you look at, you've got 2 weeks on your schedule free. And you're like, you know what? I want to go to Mars. And you say, hey, Siri, Alexa, Toby, whatever, whoever your artificial intelligence, Bryce 2.0. can I go to Mars? It's like, yeah, Brian, there's actually a slot in the next 9 hours for you to do the Mars transit. A robot, self-driving car pulls up to your front of your house. You walk out, you don't bring anything because, 3D printing and all that is such the point that, whenever you show up in a hotel room, it's going to have your favorite toothpaste and all that ready for you. You hop in this car, it drives you to the airport where you hop up on an electric jet driven by a robot powered by massive solar arrays or fusion or whatever. Energy costs are ridiculously cheap. You're taken to a spaceport where maybe you use a chemical rocket. You could maybe use one of those airship to orbits to get there. You might be maybe use an antimatter space plane to get there, or another option, which I'm under a non-disclosure agreement to tell you about. Okay, then you fly up to a space station, right? And you get up on this little pod. They put you in this thing that's the size of a little minivan. Maybe there are two other people in there, and you got virtual reality helmets and all sorts of stuff to keep you occupied, and maybe really good drugs. They press the button, laser ray ignites. And you have a 3-day journey to Mars. And along the 3 days there, you could tune out, you could do virtual reality, whatever. And then 3 days later, you're in Mars orbit and you go to the Mars station and take a landing craft back onto the surface of Mars. And that fast.
It would be what like a cross country train trip would be, in the locomotive era of America, like to go from New York to San Francisco or something like that, maybe even shorter than that.
Mm-hmm. And far, far more things to fill your time with to entertain you because of virtual reality technologies, we can make this interior of this spacecraft that's tiny, a tiny craft, because we don't want to pick up too much weight, but we can make this thing feel like it's a humongous interior.
Well, and you can even run simulations of what you're going to do when you get there. You can, for example, one of the things when you come to a new city, you familiarize yourself with the city, right? So instead, over that 3-day journey, essentially, they run a version of Grand Theft Auto 5 where it's like you play a game that's sole purpose is to familiarize yourself with the spaceport you're about to land into. And then they give you tasks and you, I don't know, maybe earn money or rewards or something for finishing them. And then along the way, it says, oh, well, you crossed, you violated local laws here. You did that. I mean, it takes all of that locked productivity time that is essentially spent, reading Moby Dick or something right now, and makes it all of a sudden productive time that, prepares you for everything. That would be amazing.
We play video games and watch Netflix and sit on our iPads, Brian. I mean, it could be.
No. I mean, I'm thinking in terms of productivity. I mean, of course, entertainment. You can already do that.
Sure. I just love that even in this far flung version of the future, Brian is already girding himself for how future tech will affect the violation of local ordinances.
Well, I mean, that's already something. I don't know. Whatever. I mean, it's
it. No, this is the full picture. A lot of these other science podcasts, they're going to tell you all the cream, right? All the big, beautiful dreams.
You wouldn't want to know local traditions or local.
I agree. I totally agree that you're going to spend. You should spend some of that time, on that trip, reading up. But I can tell you, every time I've flown international for 20 hours or something like that. The amount of time that I decided to actually spend reading my little language manuals or what I need to do or know not to do, not as much as I should have.
Well, exactly, and that's my point, is that right now it's work. It's a boring technology. You're reading stuff. You're like, ugh. But instead, if you could essentially feel like you're there already to where the moment you got off, you've had, two or three days of rehearsal of doing interesting stuff. And then you walk off and all of a sudden you're walking around like a local. I don't know.
That's huge. And there is, I think, a whole larger conversation that we can have about kind of our own decision paralysis in new situations, because it's something that I find very, very fascinating. But I totally get your point.
I do too, Brian.
Right on. High fives all over.
Hey, you want to know what point I also get, as well as everybody else, including Bryce, who's going to show his screen in 5 seconds, is patreon.com/weirdthings.
What is the point of patreon.com/weirdthings?
All right, so here's the deal, right? You just go ahead on over to patreon.com/weirdthings, and you can support this show. A lot of people have been saying forever that, like, hey, what if are we at peak Weird Things? Is Weird Things an insustainable resource? Well, I am here to tell you that scientific studies now show that we will continue to do Weird Things forever as long as patreon.com/weirdthings continues to thrive. Do your part to conserve, reuse, and recycle Weird Things by going to patreon.com/weirdthings and making sure that this show happens every single Sunday, as well as After Things, the show in which we reconfigure from news of the weird and science commentators to entrepreneur and business life coaches and talk about our own pathways as well as helping yours. It's all there for you, friends. Patreon.com/weirdthings.
Gentlemen, would you like some weird news? Weird,
oh, weird revelation? Yeah. No, I want to get weird.
Let's go.
Okay, now we have a problem here on this show, and that is that we basically have a wizard running the controls here that I can think about a topic, and there's a good chance that a second later Bryce will have this up on screen.
All right.
Okay.
Wait, that's a problem?
Don't do that yet. No, it's okay. Not actually. It's awesome.
But, I gotcha. Gotcha.
Yeah, you're good. Bryce, by the way, guys, for everybody listening on audio, you do not know how awesome Bryce is when it comes to that. It's like you will be saying, so there's a project, and I'm reading Starshot on the screen because he's already figured it out and got it loaded up, and it's incredible. It is I do not want to get into a shootout with you. just like that. He just threw up a graphic of that. Brian and Justin, and I want the chat room, don't say nothing. Don't say nothing.
Say nothing. See?
All right.
So, oh, look at this. In typical Bryce fashion, he's already removed the chat from the program feed, so none of us know what the chat's saying.
If I say recent news, Loch Ness Monster, does that mean anything to you guys?
No.
No.
What if I told you?
May I make a guess? The new headline is, recent news, Loch Ness Monster, still not real. What if
I told you somebody put a robotic submarine into Loch Ness, they looked down there, and they saw the silhouette, the shape of the Loch Ness Monster?
I would say that seems an awful lot like all the other pictures that are not necessarily conclusive and only seem to show this creature in either blur or shadow.
Well, what would you say if I told you this was the same shape, matched the popular description of Loch Ness Monster? Many people would agree, absolutely say yes, this is what Loch Ness Monster would look like.
That's a tough one.
That would certainly match well-documented phenomenon wherein people are taking random patterns and assigning worth to it, and they are noticing it because it is the popular description, not that they have found something that happens to match the popular description. I say good day.
What if I were to tell you this was spotted in the exact location where somebody said, yes, you will find this here?
I would say that this is looking more like a hoax, as we now have somebody that is directing such chicanery and tomfoolery, directing submarines and whatnot to their own folly.
Well, gentlemen, it's all true. A robot submarine in Loch Ness found the Loch Ness Monster.
Wow. Holy cow. As a matter of fact, the headline on CNN says Loch Ness, quote unquote, monster found in Scotland. Hold on.
Oh,
you ruined it. You killed it with that word. All right.
A survey. A survey team led by Kongsberg Maritime Limited has released a high quality scan of the Loch Ness Monster. Is that
it does? It looks like Nessie.
Yeah, it does. It really does.
All right, you ready for the backstory on this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
there was a Billy Wilder film called The Private Life of Sherlock Holmes, which was sort of a more comedic look at Sherlock Holmes, detailing his quirky nature, perhaps his drug addiction, did he like women, etc. And one of the cases in there was a sightings of the Loch Ness Monster that turned out to be a submarine, I think, powered by midgets. And they built a Loch Ness Monster-looking submarine for the movie. They took it out to Loch Ness, but Wilder's like, you know what? I don't like those humps, which are actually there for buoyancy. They took off the humps, and the submarine promptly sank.
Oh, this is amazing! This is a factual finding of the actual of an actual Loch Ness Monster.
Yep.
That is amazing.
That's great.
That's one of the, I'm looking at the photos of it now. That's extraordinary.
He's like autoerotic asphyxiated Loch Ness Monster.
That's so great. Here's what I love is that it's a case where it's like enough people want there to be a Loch Ness Monster that enough people start fantasizing and creating, you know, imagery of a Loch Ness Monster, that enough people actually end up sinking and losing Loch Ness Monsters that we could go discover later. So it's like the dream becomes reality.
I'm gonna tell you what's going to make it even more messed up is there's a, in California, there's a community that's got these sand dunes there, and buried in the sand dunes is an Egyptian temple, which I think we talked about before, which was, I think, one of the early productions of Ten Commandments, or like a first Ben Hur. I think it was like the first time they did Ben Hur. And then it was eroded away, and then later on when the sand dunes started to erode, you would see what looked like an Egyptian temple in the middle of, you know, California desert, which I used for my book Hollywood Pharaohs. I borrowed that whole entire premise for that. But Brian, circa 30, 40 years from now, is going on his Mars trip and calls up all of his fellow Diamond Head cohorts. Diamond Head, it's a new thing I'm starting. It's what we call them on Mars, Diamond Club.
I like Diamond Head, though.
We launched from Diamond Head, Hawaii. That's where it starts from. So yeah. All of the Diamond Club Mars people, we get together out in the desert of Mars, and we're like, guys, you know what would be funny? Let's build a Martian city, right? And we make a little fun movie, whatever, a Patreon campaign. Like, hey, you know, let's build our time machine so we can go back and see if there really were Martians. And then we forget about it. It gets covered. 50, 60 years later, it starts to erode, and people find the Martian city that we made, but they're really confused.
Yeah. Well, and that's...
Let me take that one step further with Loch Ness specifically. Right now, I mean, listen, there's a reason why that phrase, Loch Ness Monster, gets headlines around the world. There is a great interest in the idea of a Loch Ness Monster. It has been a part of popular culture on both sides of the Atlantic for a very, very, very long time. Let's flash forward a little bit to a point where you can genetically create animals, maybe cloning or something is in a different place, and you can maybe not to the size of how we imagine Nessie, considering how deep Loch Ness is, there is some kind of creature for which the municipality surrounding that area funds. So as a tourist trap that there is now, by way of the popular legend of Loch Ness Monster, an actual organism for which lives in or around Loch Ness, and every once in a while they throw it in the water and it swims around and everybody takes pictures.
Well, I'll tell you what it makes me think of is like what happens when you reach a constraint-free economy where all of a sudden nobody has to work who doesn't want to, and we have robots to do everything or whatever. And I think I suspect the answer is that we all become artists. And whether your contribution to the art the artistic sphere is to create a hoax that lasts for 100 years or to make an old hoax reality or whatever. I mean, it's like in little ways, we're already doing that.
I think that we certainly, if you look at the amount of time we spend now creating ways to entertain each other, like I can't turn around, like, you know, you used to think Starbucks were everywhere, like escape rooms in LA are everywhere now. You know, they're like walking down the street. Wait, there's an escape room there. Getting to my apartment. Look, there's an escape room there. So that's become a very popular form of way of entering ourselves. I certainly see that increasing tremendously.
That's awesome.
Well, and it reminds me a bit about, we saw that in the Ian M. Banks novel Player of Games, where it's like, you know, the culture, this post-singularity world where it's like all you have to do with your time is to gain prestige for being better at playing more types of games than other people and becoming renowned for it.
I think we could do an entire episode one day on the pros and cons of that constraint-free economy and you know, the idea of what happens when you don't have to work and you get paid your stipend kind of thing or whatever, and why I think that may be a horrible idea and why it might be a good idea. But
I do know maybe there's a good way to segue into picks, but a recent episode of Freakonomics posed that question, and it came to the science fiction-y twist ending of saying that, hey, well, we have a precedent for this. You know, what happens? Because the question is, what happens to jobs when robots can do enough of everything? And their answer eventually got to, sounds nutty, but we've already seen this happen with dogs. Dogs used to have jobs. They used to be, you know, they would herd things. They would provide security. They would do all the stuff that people didn't want to do. And now they don't do any of those things. They still have those instincts. We still deal with them. But pretty much their whole job now is to be kept animals. And, of course, there's more dogs than ever. So
And we destroy tens of thousands of dogs every day because they don't have a function.
That's touche, sir. But yes.
And that's there's a thing that sounds cool, but then there's, from the economics point of view, it's like, do we want a society in which we treat 90% of the population as a parasite?
I don't know. I mean, you say a parasite's an interesting turn of phrase, because it's like I would think we would treat them as customers, because let's say at some point, you know, there's enough wealth and I don't know. Maybe
we should do another episode. I'm all for this. I don't have – no, Brian, this is the way it is. But I have this at first. I'm like, oh, that's a cool idea. But then when I started thinking more deeply about it in reading some several thoughts, I'm like, there's a lot of scary implications there that we could talk about. But I say – we dive into picks.
You know what? Actually, I'll make a pick based on this because
it's cheating, Brian. It's cheating.
No. My pick, and maybe it's one. It's a book that I read almost 20 years ago. I should probably go back and read it again. But it's Neal Stephenson's *The Diamond Age*, where the opening scene, minor spoilers here, is that a whole bunch of people are gathered around for the inauguration of this island. And this is a case where it's been years and years of effort. They've programmed all the nanobots to create all the items that do all the things. And the architect is there, and I don't know, I'm making this part up, but the mayor's there and everyone's really excited. And then they all gather around, they press the button, and the nanobots go to work, and they actually manufacture right in front of you an island with giant diamond sculptures and beautiful, you know, poetic whatever. One of the things that he proposes in this world is that people will split. They will splinter into different cultures because they can afford to be anything. And the Vikis, the Victorians, are a class of people who realize that, hey, well, if we're going to pick just randomly out of any one spot, it seems like the Victorians had a lot of structure to what they're doing, and that we could model, we can live that way. And so Victorians would you know, adopt the language of the late 1800s. They would they had parlor rooms that people would come in and wait before they would be seen by other people. But behind the scenes, what's happening is thousands of nanobots are scrubbing other thousands of nanobots to make sure that there's no viruses or contagions or whatever. And then meanwhile, there were, you know, if you wanted to, you never had to, you know, you didn't have to worry about eating. You didn't have to worry about getting ahead. But if you wanted to contribute to society, that's how you got to be quote unquote rich, whatever that means. In a world where you could just ask robots to manufacture atom by atom a diamond of whatever size and shape you want, what does it mean to be rich? So it's like there's prestige of other people, and there's you know,
owning land, Brian, same as it's always been.
maybe so. This is have you read it by any chance, Andrew? Did you ever read The Diamond Age?
I got it. I read years ago, like the first five or six chapters, and it was Stevenson is either like Anathem is one of my favorite 10 sci-fi books of all time. This is one that I just kind of just got into this. I couldn't finish it.
Interesting. But it really stuck with me for a long time. I think I'll go do the audiobook because I read Snow Crash like 15 years after I read it the first time. I did it again and as an audiobook and loved it. And so maybe it's worth another revisit for me.
Yeah, I listen. Everybody I know has read Seven Eves, loves it, so I'm going to have to read that at some point.
I liked it a lot. I loved Aurora, though. Thematically, Aurora by Kim Stanley Robinson is very similar to Seven Eves. Strangely, I found Aurora more optimistic, which is weird because they're both very, very pessimistic novels.
Hey, speaking of optimism, I read a book. I think I might have even shouted out on this show before, but I finished it. It is The Run of His Life, story of the O.J. Simpson trial written by Jeffrey Toobin.
Oh, dude, you're diving all the way into the O.J. lore, because I remember it was you that turned me on to that 30 for 30 special where it was all just found footage from the day that the O.J. trial happened along with the...
I forget the title of that one, but that's one of my favorite documentaries ever. There's another O.J. Simpson 30 for 30 that is like six parts and is apparently insanely good that has yet to come out. But this is the book for which the television show, the fictional television show, or fictional dramatized, rather, television show is based on. It is certainly extremely well-sourced. Very obviously, the Jeffrey Toobin had access to members of the defense team, he has very good police sources. He quotes things that came from the police file, and it gives you a blow by blow, reasoning on how that trial went the way that it did. And a lot of things that are, kind of swept under the rug. If people like the TV show, a few of the things that they point out that the TV show, didn't really have much use for is just exactly how well the defense team manipulated the media, which has gone over, but even to the point where there was this idea that, behind the scenes, OJ was masterminding his defense strategy, that he was, and this was very much the creation of Johnny Cochran and Effley Bailey and Shapiro, that like he was the one really like saying who they should call and this, that, and the other, which was a complete fabrication. OJ, to nobody's surprise, beyond everything, that trial became beyond the actual crime that was committed, was kind of just a dumb athlete, whether or not he was a murderer, spoiler alert, he was, He barely the note that he wrote that was read by Robert Kardashian on television and then subsequently published in newspapers and magazines across the world was almost uniformly corrected for grammar and spelling and obscured the fact that OJ was almost functionally illiterate. The note itself is just rife with spelling errors and grammatical errors, and the idea that that at that point, it was the decision of maybe 20 people to just correct that when they were writing it into actual newspaper copy or magazine copy is just crazy. Because you could only imagine that would just be, people would take pictures and post it on Twitter immediately, and that would be a lot clearer in today's world than it was back in the mid-90s. There's a lot of really fascinating things there. And the O.J. Simpson trial, obviously now going through, it is apparently crossed through our vein of, hey, that was a thing that happened, to, hey, this is nostalgia and let's pick it apart. But listen, it is weirder than you think. Like, as much as you remember the O.J. Simpson trial, man, it is so, so, so bizarre to look at that trial, which was, I think, very much undeniably the cross section of a lot of elements in pop culture and very specifically the media.
There was a great article by Vincent Bugliosi after that explaining his – the headline was, I could have convicted O.J. Simpson with a legal pad and a pencil. It was just,
Yeah, and that's –
very much a good dismantling after the fact, but since then all the others are the details.
Without a doubt. And that book is unkind – to Marcia Clark and Christopher Darden specifically. Marcia Clark comes off in the book, and from anybody that can that can tell, you know, she was a fierce, almost like, you know, superhero-esque kind of like driven to justice for victims kind of prosecutor that just wound up getting buffaloed in that trial for a million different reasons, and many of them very much of the prosecution's own making. But I found it fascinating. It's really, really, really well written, and certainly does not dance on any lines on spelling out just exactly how much overwhelming evidence there was to point to O.J. Simpson having murdered Nicole Simpson and Ron Goldman.
Did you do the audiobook or actually read the text?
Oh, these eyes don't read anymore.
Yeah, dude, I'm so with you. And it's like I'm so over people acting as though the ability to look at printed text and translate it into the meaning of the words behind it is some kind of precious gift, and we're all in sixth grade and we're impressed that you can read very long books or whatever. It's like, I ain't got time for that. It's like I experience vivid hallucinations because I have the world's best storytellers who've read the book ahead of time and know the right things to emphasize, put on a mind production in my brain while I deal with the tedium of meat space.
Yeah, well, I thought it was very, very, very well read. So check it out. Run of His Life by Jeffrey Toobin.
I think they both have their value for format.
Stop fighting the line.
From somebody whose majority of my work is not out on ebook or audiobook,
yet.
Although, guess what comes out this week? This week, Name of the Devil on Audible.
Oh, sweet, 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 sweet. I had no idea. I'm so very excited about this.
Name of the Devil. Name of the Devil, by the way, Thriller Award nominated book, the sequel to Angel Killer, but you can read it standalone. Angel Killer's on Audible too. Name of the Devil is an Audible book. Audio book.
That is wonderful. Is there any of the behind the scenes you can talk about that? Because, is it the same reader and
same reader we had before? So, great. Narrator.
No, I love it. Reader. Check. Yeah, no, I sound like an idiot. This is one of the biggest flaws of me as a human being is I've been friends for a decade now with Andrew Main, but yeah. It wasn't until there was an audiobook that I could actually.
Yeah, I wouldn't call that a flaw. But...
Big flaw. We could keep going and just name flaws. You want to go, Andrew? You want to start?
There's no shortage.
My pick is not Name of the Devil, although I hope it's all of your picks. If you guys go in there and click that as Audible,
I'm buying it right now.
Yep, me too.
It will help me out a lot. They track those numbers or buy it on Amazon. Buy the CD. Buy the 8-track. My pick is another look back, nostalgic look about sort of the beginning of reality TV, commercial culture. How our attention's captivated and driven by competition reality. And I'm talking, of course, about the movie available now on Netflix, The Running Man, written by an obscure novelist known as Richard Bachman. At least that's what his name is in the titles for this. And it is a remarkably fun movie that I think holds up in many ways, directed by Paul Michael Glaser, who is from Starsky & Hutch, actually. It's a funny movie, and Richard Dawson in it is playing this sort of preening reality TV host kind of guy, you know, in the age of, what we have now is surprisingly entertaining. I'm enjoying Maria Conchita Alonso at peak. Maria Conchita Alonso is amazing. So The Running Man is my pick.
Well, and it was a weird line that he played when he in that role, because this is at the height of his popularity or near the end of his popularity as the host of Family Feud. And before then, mm-hmm. throughout all the 70s, he had
already kissed all the moms.
Correct.
On the lips.
He had appeared as guests on all of the game shows. So this is somebody who was a well-beloved institution in game show television. Essentially playing a really horrific caricature of what he already was. And I remember, it's been a long time since I watched it, but I remember finding it really disquieting as a kid to see him, you know, essentially playing himself, but just with the right amount of darkness and bloodlust and pragmatism. I don't know. It was kind of horrifying.
So,
but it was.
Sorry, go ahead. Go ahead. Explain.
No, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Oh no! I was gonna go in another direction. So let's get all the Running Man analysis in.
No, I just gonna say that it was neat because remember Dawson was a guy that he was in Hogan's Heroes. This is a guy that had a history as an actor who then fell into the game show thing, which is if you're a successful game show host, an extremely lucrative career, and you kind of never want to step away from it because what you do. And for him to then go do Running Man and to sort of just take the piss out of that character and play this guy that's super nice to everybody. And then, the moment, some guy at the mop crosses him, he's, telling him to fire him when he's in the elevator. I mean, it's a caricature, but it's really, really good.
How has this movie not been remade?
Be careful what you say.
I'm certain somebody has it optioned at some level. There is only one Richard Bachman tale that has not been made into a movie yet. And it's
The
Long Walk. That's correct. Everything else has been made into a fairly big property. I gotta feel like it's kind of like the Philip K. Dick thing, where it's like, there's fresh turf to be mined before they start doing retreads.
No, there's been plenty of attempts to try to put this into being remade because it's been the Bachman stuff has been pretty has made interesting material. You're going to be hard-pressed to find a relatively faithful Philip K. Dick adaptation that did really well.
Yeah.
Outside of Blade Runner, but that probably violates
that's
the faithful.
That's not a faithful adaptation. Yeah. That's we take the source material and we make something radically different from the book. And then I think things like, I thought Adjustment Bureau was pretty good. There's been some other stuff that it's gotten better, but a lot of his stuff is just so weird. But yeah, when it comes to faithful, Blade Runner had to just take this premise and then change it dramatically, and that was not an economically successful film when it first came out.
Mm-hmm. I guess I just kind of feel like this is like between Hunger Games meets Deadpool. Like we could do a rad Running Man movie. Like that would they could be a big hit these days, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree. I'm down. I'm for it.
Yeah. Arnold's hinted at it. You could do a version of it where Arnold was playing the game show host.
that'd be perfect. We can all agree that we need the big, like Arnold defined his final act as an actor, right? Like where he just settles into the kinds of roles that are befit him. And I think he's kind of tried to fit himself, wedge himself kind of back into the action thing, which has not necessarily been super successful, but I would love to see him just on charm alone, just rock a role like that. I think that'd be great.
It'd be cool, and he could do all the one-liners. Now, Running Man is really part of what I loved about it is how it sort of just kind of got TV. There's a moment where, spoiler alert, Arnold is this guy sent into this dystopian version of LA where they have these stalkers who try to kill him and other game players there. And there's the point where he makes his first kill, right? And then he surprisingly kills the guy in the hockey rink with barbed wire around the guy's neck. And it cuts back to the studio audience and everybody's sad because their favorite stalker's been killed. And Richard Dawson's we'll be right back after these commercial messages. this national tragedy has befallen us as our beloved mass murdering hitman has been killed before our eyes, and it's the sad music's already queuing, and it's like if you go back and you watch Verhoeven Starship Troopers and you realize how clever that movie was.
Yeah,
it's the same sort of thing.
Absolutely.
So anyhow, gentlemen, let's say we wrap this up and jump into some after things where I'm gonna have my special guest Peter Wax. So I'm going to say it's been weird. We're going to switch over to his computer here that's got a better microphone.
Okay. I'm going to take a short bio break. I'll be right back.
All righty.
Okay, bye.
Hey, Bryce.
Hey, Justin.
I got another yet another.
Was there a new Cogswell song?
We had a new Cogswell song.
Oh, I haven't seen it yet.
this one we can actually play. Okay. This one doesn't, I don't think it has any kind of horrifying profanity in it.
Go for it.
Wait, he already added another one, and he didn't even email us about it. All right, here's the hat dance.
Let's win, let's win, let's win. Let's win this thing again. Let's win, let's win, let's win. Let's all decide to grin.
We are going to win the podcast awards. That's what we're doing. We are going to win the podcast. All them are going to win.
Let's win, let's win, let's win the podcast awards again. Let's win, let's win, let's win the podcast awards a win. For the beer and stuff is our briefing. The quiz and scan school, and we have concerns of Andrew Chicken, diary of a trans woman, hypothetical health, Jerry and Joe and Jake's musical adventure, current geek worthy Phileas Club, Mad Men and Hack Five and Cord Killers, and the people's choice nobody cares at all. So pick what you want for that.
Now listen, Bryce.
Yeah.
That was good.
Oh my God.
Profanity in it.
Yeah.
We could leave it there, or we could push our luck with one I haven't listened to.
I just looked at what that. I just scrolled down on the page and I saw what it was, and I really.
What? Can I see? Give me a little peek-see. Okay. Yeah.
I say go for it.
All right. Here we go.
Then it'd be amazing.
Anything is possible. If you believe.
Here we go. Doctor Strange. Some say dry while others feel the pain. Doctor Strange. That's just a little stinger. Hey, babe, we did it! Woo! Nobody insulted Eric Clapton's dead son or cursed. Yay!
Hot damn.
We gotta, yeah.
Call the police and the firemen.
All right, let's see if this is Andrew.
All right, I'm going to use a bet.
All right, go for it.
Oh, yes, yes, y'all.
Hey, and
Andrew. Dude, that looks great.
What's up, Andrew?
Hey, when do you think they're going to announce?
This microphone's plugged in, but it's not actually picking up here.
It was.
Did not check. I'll show you.
Okay.
I can't hear.
Somebody's
hear
getting
them.
Served.
Uh-oh.
Oh, damn, man.
Hear them, by.
We're talking in hushed tones.
We're reverent.
Oh.
Test.
Tap on the microphone if you're testing it.
Here. If you tap this?
Nope.
See, watch here. Here's how to tell if it's doing onboard.
It's okay.
Doctor Strange.
And they can't hear us, so we can't walk them through this.
There's no preamp on this thing? Or is there a preamp on this?
Over there.
All right. But it's not picking it up in the settings.
Okay. There isn't it.
It's not. If you go click your microphone,
yeah,
that's your onboard.
Right.
There's no other microphone option.
So it's not reading it?
Nope.
Oh, God.
Okay. See solution.
And that also now we can hear it once you unplug that from. Do you have a dual? Is there just one mic input? Or yeah, let's do USB. I can hear you now, Brian.
Hi. How are you?
Hey.
Hi.
Brian, before we before I forget, yep. I remember the bit that we didn't do for Night Attack, and we should do this week. Which is my neighborhood's crazier than yours.
Oh yeah, the next door game where you everybody logs them. Into their local nextdoor.com, and yeah. And then if we have a contest to elect the most effed up neighborhood in America or worldwide.
Exactly.
It's pretty good.
Okay, I think our friends over in California have frozen. Yep.
Actually. Don't blame this on the sweet golden state of California.
Right.
They're in Colorado.
Oh, they're in Colorado. Oh, okay.
Their camera is high.
Well, the other angle wasn't working, so.
Well, no.
That's why we took this angle.
All right, let me.
So,
See, I like that.
Man.
Yeah, put a book.
You know who gets a little fired up?
Who?
People on the Twitter.
Oh, no.
About what? What are they all fired up about?
I'm trying to find it.
Politics. Yeah. What?
Okay. Am I right? Oh, there it is. Okay, so somebody just really was upset. Somebody watched the first episode of Hacking the System.
Hi, we can hear you. Can you hear us? Okay.
Not anymore. Not this way. He was so upset that about the breaking a car window scene that he hops on Twitter and says, "Atchwood, so you think most people are dumb enough to think a rubber mallet will break a car window, especially when you love tap it?" And then he follows it up with, "Enjoyed the rest of episode one. Thank you." And then I respond,
that's an overreaction.
I was like, I responded to the first one and be like, "Whoa, Jim, what's with this hostility?" And he goes, he says, "Please assume your audience has a modicum of intelligence, as I posted since this. I really enjoyed the rest of the episode." And I was like, okay. So he was upset at that part, but, thought the rest of it was good. And so, so I was like, "You're right. What idiot would assume that a regular hammer couldn't smash a window?" And I gave him a link to that that news guy who's taking an actual hammer and he keeps trying to smash the window. Have you seen this?
No.
We watched it. We did it on the show.
I can take your word for it.
But anyway, it's hilarious. He smashes he tries 18 million times to smash it and he can't do it.
Yeah,
but I guess me playing coy, he clearly didn't watch the video and just decided that he had a chip on his shoulder because he responds, "It was an all caps effing rubber mallet. Are you R-worded?" And I responded, and at this point I'm like, "Oh, yikes." And I'm like, "Hey, you didn't watch the video. That's a hammer. Also, please don't be upset. This is a really weird thing for you to be upset over." And he goes, "You're as dumb as a rock. If you don't know, that was a rubber mallet. I use hammers all day long, as well as mallets." Hammers and mallets are all caps. And I goes, "I just watched episode one of Hacking the System, not talking about the POS link. You show," all caps. I think he meant your show. And then he sends me a link to my own show. And then this is the part where I'm like, I don't know how to correct this. And I'm like, "Yes, we were talking about my show. And then I shared with you the clip that inspired that scene. And then you started yelling. And in that clip, which it sounds like you still haven't watched, a hammer fails to break a window repeatedly." And this is the point where I turn in. I think I'm being an ass, but I'm trying to be the most polite ass possible. I say, "Look, Jim, I'm not sure what's gone so sideways with your day that you've taken to Twitter to S-word on my stuff, but I forgive you. I'm really, really sorry for whatever it is that you're fired up over, and I hope you have a really awesome rest of the day." And I said, "If you're worried that I haven't heard you, trust me. Jim thinks Jason didn't hit a window hard enough. Noted and understood. Hugs and kisses. Please enjoy the rest of the series." Then I give him a link to the Peanuts gang dancing.
I think it improved.
And he goes, "Was I talking about that clip? No. I was talking about episode one of your show."
This is just, you're in a loop. I just have to stop.
Brian, the only way to lose is to play.
I guess so. It's just...
you can't win for trying.
Boy, so, you're not kidding.
Time ago, you could pay admission to go to Bedlam Asylum and to go look at the crazies.
Now they come to you.
Doesn't mean you had to go.
Listen, the only thing that you need to say is... There was a situation where Andrew and I had to deal with something very, very frustrating business-wise, and there was an email that was sent to the both of us, and there was one line in there that Andrew and I both agreed was fairly offensive, you know, to us personally, and I just responded to them ignoring that, and Andrew was like, "Man, that one line, though," and I was like, "Yeah, you know, I don't think that any acknowledgement of that will lead to a productive conversation, so let's just focus on everything else for which we can agree on." And that's like in that text, like literally if half the tweet was, "Hey, I like the rest of the show," then it's just the only thing that you should do is, "Hey man, thanks for watching. Really excited to see what you think of episode two."
Yeah.
It's like, especially because you've already you've gone through it twice of explaining very clearly what your argument is, and it's clear he's not interested.
Yeah, he's not interested.
You won't get them to see that way anymore.
Beyond assigning motivation, which I think is pretty clear from your situation, the internet is where context goes to die on both sides.
Yeah.
So there's a fair chance that you are misunderstanding what he is trying to say, either by him not being able to communicate effectively or you reading it incorrectly. And he is unclear on what you are trying to say based on whatever calculus between the two.
I'm sending Bryce a very cogent XKCD comic on this that sums up the entirety of my thoughts on this. And I'll let him get the email there and then post this, because it's kind of it's everything. It's everything that we could be said is said.
So the guy with the hat is they say the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and expecting different results. The second guy says, you've been quoting that cliche for years. Has it convinced anyone to change their mind yet?
Fair enough. Fair enough. Fair enough. All right.
These people are crazy, Brian, and by crazy, they do crazy things. Well, like, listen to reason.
Yes. Yeah, it's not a logic. You thought it was from a logical point, but you sussed out that it is not from.
It's not just that. The internet is really hundreds of millions of preschoolers playing telephone together.
Well, but it's three. There are only three crazy people on the internet, but all they do is spend all day on the internet saying crazy things, messing with us.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
Hey, guys, Andrew, can you guys tap on your microphone just to double check that it's the right one? There it is.
Okay. Did you hear?
Yeah, we did.
All right. Is it not loud enough?
No, it's good. I just...
didn't trust us?
No, it's because you guys are a little... I think you guys are a little distance away from it, so you get a little bit of a
yes.
sound.
Yes.
Hello. Hello.
All right. I think we're good to do after things. We did get an email...
sweet.
Heads up.
I just want you guys to know that Brian Brush is the biggest idiot in the world.
Accurate.
A mallet!
Mallet!
I work with hammers and mallet.
You got it. You're the captain of your captain hammer mallet.
I've seen a few hammers in my day.
You know, in this world, man, there's hammers and there's mallets, and I'm Brian. And the world's a piece of glass.
Understood. Brian, I respect your desire to
Hey, you guys cut out.
Cut out at the wrong time.
Yeah,
I didn't get any of that. I heard that you respect.
Falling apart here. Our signal's falling apart?
Yes.
I think he respects your drive to communicate, your steely-eyed glare, your resolve, your judo moves,
your very sweet hair,
ability to listen to words.
Oy.
The thing and stuff that dreams are made of.
I mean, I've been back for a while, but
filling in for Andrew, waiting for him to pick up his sentence
any moment. Brian, what I'm saying is I admire and respect your willingness to engage with people. That is commendable.
Yes, but also I will recognize that it is probably lost on many, many people.
I'm leaving it at that, Brian. It's just a compliment.
It's fine.
Leaving it at that.
It's fine.
I work with compliments.
I got you. Beat me to it.
Things every day.
Oh, we forgot to plug heading the system on the episode, but
dang it.
But there's still the nominations are 2 weeks.
Voting times, yeah.
Nominations are 2 weeks.
Do I need to nominate?
Peter goes upstairs like, oh, Diet Coke would be great. He comes out a big, thick cup of coffee. So I just had to take out the water and go, it's as good as a Diet Coke. You don't want me as a house guest. You don't want me as a house guest.
Are you particular?
Take a wild guess.
No, I'm like, don't do anything for me. Don't do anything for me, because if you do, no, I'll make a wish.
T2T2 says the nomination number still counts mostly. Is that the number of nominations?
Yeah, number of people nominated.
Who are nominated.
They take it into effect.
So, yeah. Yeah, they got a bunch of other rando
Thank
stuff.
Thank you, sir.
Would Monsieur like anything else?
I'll let you know. There's like 2 feet of snow here.
No, there's more than 2 feet.
Why?
It's April.
I don't, the state didn't fill out the right paperwork or something. They got our springs mixed up. Gross. My personal theory is that the entire state of Colorado is a Game of Thrones fan, and they just won't let go of winter.
Yeah.
Speaking of which, is it next week?
Yeah.
Next Sunday.
Next Sunday.
Oh, yeah.
Also, by the way, if you are in Austin, Atlanta, or San Francisco. San Francisco this Tuesday, but Austin and Atlanta next Sunday. There is going to be a public Game of Thrones game, a Go game, in all those cities, wherein if you are one of the top teams at the end, you will get to go see the premiere in a theater with a bunch of other Game of Thrones fans.
Oh,
so,
wow.
Whoa.
Very hopefully cool. I'll tweet that out. But I also heard a rumor that one of the actors in the Austin game might be somebody you recognize. Not me, but somebody from the show. I'm not in Game of Thrones.
Oh, I thought you meant this show.
Nope.
It's actually going to be Andrew.
There's a treat.
Yeah.
Do you hear which actor?
No. There. All right.
Do you know nothing, Justin Robert?
Either. There's hammers and there's mallets, all right? And I'm only going to explain this to you one more time.
All right. All right,
let's go.
All right, let's do this.
I'm surprised to see, like, Milplus Yarelamu down there. He's lives in Houston, not too far away from Austin, right?
Yeah, 3 hours, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right.
All right, guys ready?
Take it away in three, two.
Welcome to the After Things podcast. This is the podcast after weird things. So that's why we called it that, where we talk to you about being a creative professional. By you, I mean you, and by we, I mean me, Andrew Main, and Justin Robert Young.
Hello, everybody.
Brian Brushwood.
Yep.
And our special guest today joining us, actually in his home office studio, is Mr. Peter J. Wax, who's actually taller than he looks right now for our video viewers. He's just behind me. So Peter J. Wax is an author of numerous books, including the forthcoming Bloodletting, co-written with Mark Ryan. He also has Second Paradigm, which is available now. He's written a Veronica Mars story, as you can see there, that's available from the Amazon Worlds, was that? Like Heroes. And he's also got the Dandy Boys Mysteries with J.R. Boyette, which is also in the bundle, the Humble Bundle. He's one of my co-authors in the Humble Bundle. Available now for just 3 more days. 3 more days from when we record this. Now's your chance, folks. Get this Humble Bundle, which helps benefit the Science Fiction Writers Association, which will help their Givers Fund, which is for charitable causes. The Challenger Science Space Science Centers, which promotes space and science. Who does not like space or science? We don't want you listening to our podcast.
No, I mean, like, space and science, the hammers and mallets of our modern age.
I mean, there is a difference between the two, but yes, I agree.
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah, and you should know the difference.
So right really now, should. There's only a couple more days left on that Humble Bundle. So if you want to hop on over there and buy that, I think for $15, you can get all the books, including 4 previously unpublished Frank Herbert novels that Peter explained to me were considered a little bit too weird and out there in their day. But right now, on point.
They're absolutely amazing. My favorite of them is Angels Fall, just this like survivor story from this plane crash in the Amazon, and you know, people trying to get through the Amazon and weather the terrain, and there's, you know, of course, aliens and stuff. It's Frank Herbert, but it's awesome stuff. But you can see why, you know, surviving a plane crash in a remote place would be zeitgeist now.
Sure.
But lost on the 50s and 60s.
I don't know if that still zeitgeist, but yes.
Right.
Hey, guys, you know, part of what we like to do here is we like to try to give some advice to people. We're not licensed advice givers, and everything we say should be maybe broached with a doctor first. But I think we have actually an email from somebody who wants our wise counsel.
Oh, yeah. Take it away, Bryce.
Okay, this is from James Harrison.
Oh, I know this James. Yeah. This is a friend of the show for a very long time.
He writes, "Hey, weird hosts. I don't know if you've covered this question, but I'll ask anyway. I've come up with a magic trick that I've performed for several hundred people, including numerous restaurants, performed many times on stage and at the Magic Convention in Toronto, and it was very well received. I've thought about putting it out on the market, but a couple of things make me hesitant. First, the trick is not 100% original, though to be fair, nothing ever is, especially in magic. How do I know if I change the trick enough that it's worth publishing and worth putting out on the market for purchase? Second, how do I go about actually getting the product in front of customers? Do I attempt to try to sell it on my own, or do I go out to one of the bigger companies there? Thanks in advance, James Harrison."
Hey, so this is interesting because I wonder how much of the, I think both me and Andrew could, and certainly Justin could speak to a bit of what we understand the gentleman's rules in the world of magic. Magic is a lot like comedy in the fact that we don't have any kind of, in comedy you could copyright the words of a joke, but you can't really prevent someone from ripping off the beats of a joke, the heart of it, there's similar situations. So as a result, in magic, you kind of have to self-enforce this kind of stuff. In the world of authoring, before we talk about it in the world of magic, I would love to know if you have any insights on, do authors get accused of, I'm saying this knowing full well the answer, but do authors get accused of completely ripping off note for note the works of other folks?
Peter explained to me an example of this, and I don't know how much you can describe or say to that effect, but of a very popular TV and series based on a fantasy series. And
okay, you're gonna have to remind me because my mouth wags and my brain shuts off.
So I don't want to say anything, but we can speak a roundabout, and then I'm gonna draw you a little picture here. That is absolutely
coming out.
We've talked about before about, and I get into this a little bit in my book. Be very derivative and go in their own direction, like 50 Shades of Grey.
Yeah, 50 Shades of Grey is the great example. Mm-hmm. It was originally a fanfic written about the Twilight universe, and it was doing so well as fanfiction that she basically just rebranded it, and she changed vampires and werewolves into business people. And yeah, so of course, a lot of people have said, "Oh, well, she just ripped it off from Twilight. She just whatever." But I mean, to the tune of a $1 billion franchise, does it matter?
And nobody watching Fifty Shades of Grey would, at that point, it went through several evolutions to where it became 50 Shades. Nobody reading it now or seeing the movie is going to think this is Twilight.
Right.
You have to know the history of it in order to know the connection. But there have been other examples in fantasy genres and urban fantasy where somebody has a really interesting premise and maybe an author puts out a book once every 2 years or so and somebody else goes, "I like this premise. I'm going to do that too." And then that thing, maybe because they release more frequently, becomes more popular and maybe gets optioned for TV and causes problems. But
And there is a big case that you can find if you go and hunt around paranormal. If you go and hunt around for paranormal romance and urban fantasy and look for, maybe some big stories about people who are taking things. Another one recently was actually Sandra Bullock.
Gravity, yeah.
Gravity, yeah. That was actually a really big deal. Mm-hmm. Somebody who had, a writer who had not only put out the book, but who had written and sold the screenplay for it. And then it coming around through several mergers and acquisitions to basically being very same scripts, lawsuits back and forth.
Yeah, it was the woman who, I forget her name, she's the one that created Rizzoli and Isles, but she wrote a book about a woman on a space station trying to stop a plague that's affected her husband.
Yeah.
And it was called Gravity. And so the large theme is female doctor, space station, crisis. And then when Gravity first came out, she made a statement saying, "No, this is different from mine, blah, blah, blah." But then
she says something different, and we don't know. And it may have been she new information came out about, you know, could be that, you know, where development went and whatever, because sometimes people option something and the option's up and they go in a different direction, but maybe they have elements. So I won't say either way. I've nothing about that particular case, know really what's going on, but it's certainly what it's going to be problematic, because those things are really, you have to, it's almost impossible to win one of those things if they're not really taking verbatim things from you.
You know, Strengths here mentions, did they remove the necrophilia and bestiality from 50 Shades? I want to point out that you're actually missing a key component. There's also pedophilia in there when the 200-year-old is chasing the 15-year-old girl.
Oh, jeez. Hey,
listen, man, we all got local laws and customs. all politics is local.
So, in answer to the question about the magic trick, if you say you have something that's not 100% implying, but it's different, but then you say, hey, but if I change it enough, can I then market it? Which means it's not different enough right now. And so your goal is, can I change this even more and then market it? First things first is it's you have to ask, what is your goal? If your goal is reputation and you want to release it, then your responsibility is to reach out to the creator, if there's still a person creating, making money from the original version, and say, hey, do I have your permission to do this? If they say no, then if your goal is reputation, then you back off and you say, okay, I'm not going to do that. If your goal is purely financial, then you can say, okay, legally I'm within these terms, I can do this, do that. And if you find that, you know, it's an attractive enough product that other people want to carry. And that's the hard part a lot of people have to understand, is they go, well, I'm in the right to do this. Legally you can imitate a lot of things, but are you going to be accepted by the magic community? You know, they're not going to go, well, yeah, technically you're right, that's okay with us. If they perceive you as ripping somebody off or profiting unfairly from it, there's a penalty for that.
Now, if it's only pieces of the construct, not the entire effect, just small pieces, would something like, you know, doing a hats off or a nod to the inspiration, you know, say pieces of this trick were inspired by this?
Speaking in generalities, it's hard.
Yeah, magic is not a matter of... You know, there are only so many ways that you can make a certain thing happen in general. And I would say there is nothing that can go wrong, in my opinion, unless you are just looking to put out as much as possible and have, you know, the chips fall where they may, because you don't care about your reputation within the industry, to reach out, you know, and have more information rather than less. And when you reach out to people, try to come out as open-palmed as possible, because very often magic creators are very, very defensive of things that they've done, and you will find very, very quickly resources and creators and people, historians, that will be able to point you in the right direction on who to talk to and in what areas you are either going to have to massage the trick to make it significantly different, or if you are in the right. But the more information you have, specifically within magic, and again, there are 20 people in the entire magic industry, so, you know, these people are not hard to find. Everybody's got everybody's email.
Well,
yeah, there.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, please, Brian.
Well, I was going to say, you know, it's really not rocket science if you're going to release something in magic. Just imagine what you expect the most obvious negative response you'll get. If somebody wanted to cause trouble, they're going to call you a ripoff of somebody's thing, right? So reach out to that guy and say you reached out to that guy. And then the ball's in that guy's court. Either he's going to say, I am the arbiter of this is too close to my stuff and I'm going to be the one who tells you no. Then you know, you then take that back. And the guy, then you could say publicly, hey, I do a variation on this routine. You know, if you bought it from this guy, I wanted to release it. He said I can't, but, you know, here's my variation. I'm going to give away for free. If assuming you've bought this guy's original routine, so the original creator gets whatever, then you maintain the reputational high ground in that regard. But that's not likely what's going to happen. What's likely going to happen is you're going to say, hey, this is based on your idea, your routine. I want to lavish praise upon you and tell the whole world that they should really buy your work because it's very good. And that person will be very flattered, very honored. It will raise his prestige within the magic community, and he'll probably be fine with it.
Yeah, if they're, you know, if you're taking money out of somebody's pocket
then you're going to get one reaction. You know, and there's, I have a trick called Teardown, which is an impromptu newspaper tear. And when I put Formative Magic Lectures, which is one of the strongest pieces, the core of that effect came from a trick invented by Jim Steinmeier called the Incessant Newspaper Tear, which appeared in his book, The Conjuring Anthology, which is a fantastic book. And I was digging through there and I saw this, said, man, there's this method, but I could use this in an impromptu setting. I could use it for this way. I reached out to Jim and I said, hey, you know, I love this method. I have this different version of this. You know, can I, you know, pay you an honorarium or whatever for this to use it and all that and mention the book in the video? Super gracious, super eager to do that, you know, but he deals with people who will say like, hey, can I use this? And will you send me a copy of your book to plug, you know? And so there's the opposite effect. And he was cool. And but he didn't have to say yes to that, you know, and it could have been, I would have tried to find out some different, we would not have drawn a comparison between the two tricks other than if you knew the method, but I wanted to do the right thing. And he's an amazing magic creator. And I wanted to respect that.
Here's what I suspect happens to a lot of magicians is they have an idea and they're scared to ask the person who inspired it because they're afraid that they'll say no. And then what they end up doing is making things much, much worse for themselves because then they do it first and then they find themselves in a position where they have to, you know, they're either crossing their fingers and they're like, oh, nobody realized that it's awfully similar to this other guy's thing. Or, you know, it blows up, in which case they deeply regret it and then they have to offer a billion mea culpas. Don't make it a either he gives you permission or you're screwed situation. Instead, he's either going to say, yes, that's lovely. Please mention me in your notes and you'll do that. Or he'll say, no, I'm not cool with this. In which case, in your mind right now, just decide you're still going to publish it, but you're going to publish it as supplementary notes. That is your an essay on your variations that doesn't give away his method, that makes it clear that if you want to do this trick, you need to buy it from this guy. But this is the James Harrison variation on that, if you have that trick.
I would even say, like, if he says yes, if he says no, then drop it. Don't even, because if he says no, and then you go put out some material relating to it, even if you're not exposing it or whatever, that could be construed from that person's point of view that he asked you not to do it, or that it was a criticism of his presentation. It won't. I can see many ways that would, your best intentions would go the other way.
The biggest thing is just communication. Communicate with him. Say if he's like, I don't like it as a commercial thing, and then if you say, all right, well, I was thinking about it. I really like it, and I've never released anything, and I'd like to gain a bit of a reputation in doing this. Do you mind if I publish it for free and link to your thing? And if he says no to that, then yeah, then drop it. But like, there's no reason why it has to, like, I think so often, specifically in magic, it gets to this like, well, I'm out of moves. I have no other moves but to do this thing. And so often that comes from lack of communication, from people digging in their heels. And this is not only from people doing things that are out of pocket, that don't have the rights or the blessings of the original creators and are legitimately looked upon as stealing from the table of somebody who put a lot of hard work into it, but also on the other side, the magic police, for which many of us have dear friends that relish in the opportunity to point fingers and shame somebody who's walked on the wrong side of that line. And I understand the need to do it, but it creates a environment where people are gun shy, and you don't necessarily need to be. Just be in communication, talk to people, figure out what, the more that you can figure out where the lines are based on what you've done and what that person's done and the way that you can make a thing happen, then the better off you're going to be, and not just kind of constantly looking at the doomsday scenario of like, well, what if? Because that is the opposite of progress.
Well, the doomsday scenario, I have an example of this in fiction. I'm going to leave names out of it very specifically. But there was a writer who wrote a story that was inspired by a song from the 70s. Incredible song. I would guess that everyone has heard it. The writer contacted the estate of that musician and requested permission to say, you know, this story was inspired by this song. And what came back from the estate was no. And not only no, but we hate science fiction so much that if you publish this, we are going to have lawyers scrub through this story looking for any reference to this song so that we can sue you. That's the doomsday. That's the only story that I have ever heard about the actual doomsday happening.
Yeah.
And with the number of stories you hear about collaboration, about inspiration, to have only heard one story from my side, I don't think it's that big of a risk.
And that's why but we'll never real. Read Tales from the Starship Shyamalama Ding Dong.
I think in magic, you're dealing with a very small community, and you're dealing with personalities that can be, you know, frustrated if they feel. And the problem is you're not dealing with reality. You're dealing with the perception of reality. You're dealing with what people perceive to be true. And Brian and I have gone back and forth this. I'll be like, oh, hey, everybody is upset about this, but they don't have any information about it. But people are still acting like telltale little children, like, oh, you know who did this, you know who did this, or whatever. And you find out that there's no facts there. It's just that people, you know, want to be angry. They want to pick on somebody for whatever reason. And so to James, back to his case is, James, my question, the thing to me is like, if you're saying you have to change it to release it, then that means what you're doing isn't sufficiently changed. And if you do want to change it and want to release it, like Justin said, just talk. If it's a living person with an existing thing, talk to them, have a conversation.
And if it's not a living person, reach out to their estate.
Yeah, or whoever owns the publishing on it. I think what he might also be saying is, how do I find that person? Because I think that's for somebody that is, you know, just invent something, but he doesn't know exactly where to find it. So if you guys have both been in situations where you want to release something that has a prior history to it, how do you find out who these people are? Who do you go to talk to?
You know, the one of the resources we used to always go to was Martin Gardner, who's since passed away. Another person who's knowledgeable is, you know, Max Maven. Max's job is not to be at our beck and call to answer our questions about who created what, but he's often very generous with that. You can reach out to, you know, Magic Castle Library. You know, you can actually write a letter to them and say, hey, I'm trying to find the history of that. We got Bill Goodwin, Lisa Cousins, we got great librarians there that, you know, can actually help people answer these questions. So there are people. Reach into the magic community, show up at a magic club or go to a magic convention and say, hey, how do I find this out? And you're going to find very quickly. Message boards, if you go into Magic Cafe or whatever, you're two steps away from finding that answer very quickly.
Yeah.
That's a lot faster than in Lit.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. It's
Lit,
a small.
You have to dig through with lawyers. You have to find, you know, the chain of custody on the copyrights. There's all sorts of stuff you have to do.
Well, and also what'll happen, though, too, in magic is you'll find out who people believe to be the creator. And one of the problems, too, is if you're – there are many times where somebody's been beat down because, like, oh, they ripped off so-and-so. And you know, well, actually, the person who we all love and respect didn't invent that, you know. And so it's kind of like, you know, it's about perceptions. It's not about really you want to do what's right, but also what's perceived as right.
Also, a cool resource is Ask Alexander. That's not going to probably do you a ton of it's not going to help you a ton in terms of finding.
I use Magicpedia all the time. Genie's Magicpedia has a bunch of precedents that tells you which trick begat which trick by whom and so on.
Yeah, and you're you know, that will do more for you learning about the history of the trick. And where things have come, add on throughout history. But, again, magic's 20 people wide. You literally can just throw a rock at somebody and they will say, ow, why'd you throw a rock at me? And you can say, because I want to find out who initiated Cart to Pocket.
Yeah, there was a group of some magician creators who got together to put together a site to protect their rights on some stuff. And it did not go well when I had a conversation with them because, like, oh, you know, we want to enforce rights on this trick and this trick. And I'm like, well, part of your consortium says this is their trick and this is their trick. These tricks, that one's 40 years older. That's 80 years older than them. And so you're going to bring down your weight on anybody who does those tricks, even though it's not original to them. And like, well, you know, he's known for this. I'm like, that's not the same. That is not the same. Because guess what? In that case, David Copperfield and David Blaine own all of magic.
Right. Correct. And that's the problem, right, is that people, when they overreact, and the only reaction you get in magic is overreaction, they're overreacting because, well, it's what? Obvious that this is that so-and-so owns it because that's who I saw it do first. And then who's this other guy think he is?
Yep. Whoever you see it first, that's who you attribute it to.
Yep.
We also had the second half of this email, if you guys want to touch on that quickly.
Oh, yeah, please.
Second, how do I go about actually getting the product in front of customers? Do I attempt to try and sell it on my own? Do I go to one of the bigger companies out there?
All right. So you come up with a trick, and it's original, sufficiently original. You talk to the person that you want to talk to. Everything's kosher. You want to put it out. Here are your options. You can either do it as a PDF. You can do it as a video. And from there, you know, no matter what, you're writing it digitally or you're shooting a video, you can send it to among the major players, Illusionist, Penguin, Theory 11. These are all places for which are constantly on the lookout for young creators with fresh methods. Many of them will front you money. They are good for you to raise your profile as a magic creator in the industry, or you can do it totally indie. Put it in a PDF. If you have any kind of a standing in message boards or places where magicians gather, you know people that are around you within your scene that might like to purchase it, you can sell it to them. And then past that, there's also wholesale opportunities like Murphy's Magic. And
here's an interesting question, is you have to decide whether or not you releasing this, are you planting seeds or are you harvesting? If you're planting seeds, then you're saying, oh, I'm going to raise my presence in the industry. I'll be known more as a creator. I've offered this contribution to the art. And in which case, you probably don't care too much about how much money is being made. You want it to get the word out about you and your magic and build your reputation. If you're harvesting, then you already have a brand. You have a pipeline. You have a mailing list. You have your fans that you can reach out to, and you want to maximize your profits and get the most out of it. One thing that I don't know if Justin mentioned is Theory 11 has The Wire, where you can publish. You know, you don't even need them to. Oh, I guess they curate it to an extent, but basically, it's like the iTunes of independent magic creations.
Okay, so I have a quick question for you guys. It's become a really, you know, standard tactic inside of speculative fiction to use Kickstarter to push promotion, to push branding, to complete projects. And it's some people say it's for the money. Most people, they've already written the project. They've already done whatever they're going to do. They're actually attempting to use the Kickstarter to garner new fan base, to bring in new people, to build the mailing list. It's more of a promotional tool. How effective would that be in a situation like this?
Not very.
No,
the reason I would say is this is Kickstarter works really well when you either have a built-in audience that's already ready there to support you, or an amazing product that people are going to, that sells itself. They go, this is incredible. If you're trying to market a magic trick, you're going to have to put up a video that shows the trick, and then you're going to have everybody in the world deconstructing what they've seen and deciding they're going to do that. I don't think there is a market for doing magic in that way on there.
The amount of time
and energy that he'll have to spend to make a good video, he would be better off doing. Cause, and also, Kickstarter, you raise money to theoretically to get your cost up, cover for distribution. But if it's a trick that he can make a video of, then I'd say, yeah, put on Theory 11's The Wire, which I think is a great resource. If you don't have the resources to produce a quality version of it and it needs a video, reach out to Penguin, reach out to Theory 11, reach out to Illusionist and say, hey, I have a trick. But if you can produce it on your own, like you can do, you know, you go on the cafe, say I have 100 copies of this, you know, I don't know if there's a market for this, whatever, see the reaction. If there's demand, you'll know there's demand. But Kickstarter can be good for some things. Like Brian used Indiegogo to create his scam stuff brand.
Well, or yeah, at least to get it started. Essentially, we used it as essentially we used it as a pre-sale operation. We had kind of a very singular product that was going to be, I think, $39, and we put together the it's still there. Look at that. That's wonderful. As an artifact. As a matter of fact, Scam Stuff, the online store, is exactly as old as my daughter is, because you'll notice in this video I point out the fact that we're having a third daughter and I needed to figure out a way to spend more time at home and still make money. So we wanted to start an online store. We set an attainable goal and did it as a pre-sales event, and we were very, very pleased with the results.
The only thing I could think of that magic-wise would have any kind of cachet with Kickstarter, and even then I can't think of a way that you'd be able to do a video that would not be like just destroyed by the magic industry itself, which is, as you might imagine, very, very serious and volatile when it comes to the ideas of things being revealed or tipped or too revealing to a general lay audience, but would be some kind of physical prop. And even then, yeah, I mean, like, by and large, there's not a whole lot in magic that costs so much that it's a mass market item. You know, there's plenty of props that cost a whole lot, that cost thousands of dollars, but they're specialty items, and you're selling it to a very, very specialty crowd. So yeah, Kickstarter, for whatever reason, just doesn't see, I can't think of something that would make a ton of sense in the Kickstarter world.
Yeah, it's been great for like novelty decks of cards and stuff, but I think that ultimately there are a lot of really good existing marketplaces. It's not hard if you're a young creator with a good idea to get it to market in Magic at all. You know, the choice is, do you want to do it on your own or do you want to work with an existing player? And the advantage of the existing players is they're pretty much straight shooters and they have built-in market to promote it, push it.
Listen, there are people in this world, and I will name them for you. Jonathan Bame, Alvo Stockman, Tim Cherno, whose job it is, they got to carve out X amount of their day to watch web videos of trembling teenage fingers with webcam shooting into their laps doing some kind of trick to demonstrate that is the trick that they have that they would like to sell. This is something that they have to do and watch probably dozens of every day to make sure that there is new fresh stuff that they are putting out on their stores. So don't hesitate to send it to them, see if they're interested in it, and otherwise, yeah, put it on the wire, put it out there, see what you can do.
Gentlemen, do you want to go to picks?
Sure.
I got a quick pick. It's not really anything on the behind the scenes stuff that we usually talk about on After Things, but I did see Jungle Book, and I thought it was a fascinating bookend too. I saw Zootopia a few weeks ago, and Zootopia is a cartoon that does an exquisite job of approaching real mannerisms of animals, whereas Jungle Book is visually appear to be real life animals approaching the personalities of human cartoons, man oh man, did the Jungle Book make me realize how good Zootopia is. Jungle Book had brief moments of brilliance, and it started off strong and it ended strong, but there was a lot of I don't tend to ever check my watch during movies, but I must have checked 3 or 4 times in this. I was a bit surprised by that. But it had a lot of heart, and it did a good job of giving nods and winks to the original animation, and I don't know. That's all I gotta say. Yeah, check it out and tell me where I'm wrong.
Did we get the songs?
Yeah, you do. But as Bonnie pointed out, nowadays when you watch a Disney musical, it's very, very highly polished and it makes a lot of sense. But this is given in the context. You got Bill Murray almost on key, almost singing at the same time as Mowgli, singing Bare Necessities. And it's more like the three of us singing Bare Necessities while a Zydeco band was playing in the background. And it was kind of adorable in that it didn't even try to do it. And they, you know, they change up some of the angles and stuff. Christopher Walken is fantastic as Louis. It was great. It was good in a lot of ways.
Yeah, it's funny. I haven't seen Jungle Book yet, but Zootopia is one of those, you know, very Pixar and Marvel kind of inspired scripts where you can tell that movie was, and in some of the behind the scenes, that movie was very, very, very dark. And they realized that it was too dark. And it was kind of dragging down the enjoyment of the movie. And you can see there are things that are just grafted on top of that movie that are just like gags. Like just straight out, absolute, silly, doesn't necessarily plug into the plot. There's a whole thing about an app that, you know, literally is just there to be a silly scene where characters can look and be silly to kind of make sure that brew ultimately comes out at the right pH level. I'm excited to see Jungle Book, but I would very much also a double recommendation to Zootopia.
Yeah, it's and it was funny because I left, like, I just wanted to, if schedules were different, if we didn't have kids, I would have just made my wife, who did not get to see Zootopia with her or with us, I would have just pushed her straight into Zootopia immediately afterward if I could have.
I mean, it is weird that we even put those two together, though.
Well, right? I mean, they're thematically the same. They're anthropomorphized animals telling a story with the counterintuitive thing of them all getting along together. You know, you got scenes of, you know, birds and panthers and tigers and elephants all hanging out together like that ever happens. It's very weird to me that the two of those came out so close and they're so very different.
But apparently they're both going to make $1 jillion. So for whatever Disney's doing, man, they got to read on it because Jungle Book opened gigantic. Hey, I got a pick. I want everybody to follow at Contender Game on Twitter and Facebook.com/TheContenderGame. Go ahead and like that because we spent all yesterday shooting what I think are very, very, very funny videos. We decided to take cards, contender cards, real cards, and stage the greatest debates that have never happened in American history. So we have a Bill versus Hillary Clinton, Bernie Sanders versus Richard Nixon. I thought it was pretty funny, and we're going to be we're going to be putting those out over the next couple weeks as we get them edited up. But yeah, actually, if you scroll up a little, Bryce, these are some of the behind the scenes pictures from the shoot yesterday. That's our Bernie Sanders, and I was very, very proud. If you keep going, our intro, I was very, very proud of. We shot that, so it's like all you'll see is just that thing with all these pictures kind of moving by, but it's all papercraft and sock puppets. I was super proud of all the hard work that Guts and Glory put into it, and I think we got a ton of stuff that we're going to be seeding out over the next couple weeks. Not only the clips themselves of the debates, but we did a ton of ad lib with all the presidents. So we'll have a lot of really, really fun stuff. Go ahead and follow those accounts because I think that y'all are really going to dig it.
Peter, do you have a pick?
Can I pick the Humble Bundle? Because that's shameless self-promotion.
Yeah, sure. Pick it.
Actually, with the politically charged atmosphere that I've been seeing more and more on social media these days and all of the seriousness that's floating around, I would love to throw a pick out there of Cards Against Humanity. Go relax with some friends and just have some good old fun.
Well, I'll have to explain to Peter what the contender is.
Is it? Okay. I'm a follow through on the contender.
I'm going to recommend my book, The Third Paradigm.
really? Okay.
No. Cards Against Humanity is a great. If you're tired of politics and playing the wonderful card game, is the contender? Then yes.
No. Listen. Cards Against Humanity is the only card game on Amazon that has a higher customer satisfaction rating than the contender. So if you're not playing the contender, then I suggest by stars alone you should be playing Cards Against Humanity.
Okay, you know what? I'm gonna share a little secret. There's a little viral thing.
There's a viral thing. You heard it here first.
Hey, guys. Colorado.
This is Texas reaching out to Colorado.
No, they can't even.
Colorado.
Hey, take that whole thing again.
Yeah. That was way more mallet than hammer.
Yeah. I don't know that we keep getting connection errors. I don't think we'll be able to. You guys have to wrap this up.
Let's just call him right back and see if we get a good
Here. We'll
good 5 minutes here.
We'll call you right back and we can wrap this
yeah,
up.
Yeah, there you go. One moment. Yeah.
Solid editing.
Man, I'll tell you what.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I went to the contender now. I thought there used to be a 3-star review at some point. I only see 5-star and 4-star.
I don't know, man. Maybe somebody saw the light.
Oh, you know what? I guess it there still is, but it is less than a full percent of
it
them.
It is now statistically insignificant, that one person who only thought we were mediocre.
Wow.
Hey, Peter's got the Cards Against Humanity public, the consumer information line number if you need that.
And it is one of the funniest things that can happen is just sitting there going through their phone tree. It's 312-756-0834. As I understand it, it was set up as a joke at a convention. One of their reps kind of let slip that the number existed, and it's only gone viral.
Oh, you
can't
great.
Find that number.
Yeah.
You just have to be given that number by somebody who has gotten it from someone.
That's funny. Awesome. So everybody check that out.
My pick before we wrap things up here and we lose our connection again is The Everything Store by Brad Stone. I probably mentioned it before. It is about the birth and growth of Amazon, which has become this giant of industry. We think of Amazon, we think of books, but it's getting everything else to your door and has now become a major back end for the web. You know, if you want to do a startup, you might be building on top of Amazon's web services. And Jeff Bezos is using his Amazon money to launch Blue Origin, which is not Amazon. It's a separate venture for him, but it is an amazing story of a modern enterprise and sort of the shape of things to come in many ways.
Right on.
That is awesome. And Glenn, look, we got the internet connection back. The miracles never cease.
For now. It's been after.
Awesome. Right. I apologize for my state's tendency to blizzard at unconventional times.
Is that what's going on?
Oh, it's crazy.
Wow. Yeah. Dude, that is great.
Yeah, man. Here, go ahead and, Bryce, if you want to click on it, just threw that in the chat room. That's a look behind the scenes at our shooting.
Ooh.
Yesterday, give a sense of
thumb. This is a symptom. Of a moral decay in America, dumb!
How soon are those going to start coming out?
Well, we got to start editing them, and what we wound up finding is we got a lot of just, you know, us being silly and joking around. So we'll probably have a lot of very very bite sized. I think it's going to primarily be just like a mobile and social campaign. Like I don't know how many. Like big videos that we'll do. Everything was kind of meant to fit in the Instagram like minute long window. So there'll be a lot of stuff coming out.
That is awesome.
It looks amazing.
Well, thank awesome. You. I do appreciate it. I mean, I'm sure it's not as funny as Cards Against Humanity's phone tree.
Well, I'm sure that once I get my copy of The Contender, I'll be throwing out my set of Cards Against Humanity.
No, it's fine. It's a great game. Very popular. I'm glad that young upstarts, Cards Against Humanity, can finally get the sunshine shown on them.
I went to a board game night over this past week, and I tried to bring The Contender out to it, and I forgot to this time. And I was on my way out, and I was like, man, I'm gonna bring The Contender next time. And one of the managers there was like, oh, I know that game. And he seemed like he really liked it.
Awesome.
Yeah. Trying to hashtag
no,
street
I'm
team.
I'm only joking. Cards Against Humanity is not a competitor. Cards Against Humanity is literally the market for which we are very, very, very fortunate to be taking place in. And in fact, the game itself is I think, very sufficiently different than Cards Against Humanity because it has now kind of come to my attention how much there are just literal ripoffs. I mean, Cards Against Humanity is the mechanics of apples to apples.
Apples to apples, right. Yeah. But you know, how quickly everyone forgets that. That's so amazing to me.
Yeah.
It's the Reddit syndrome. It's like, they're ripping off the stuff that I posted that belonged to someone else.
And The Contender is not that game. It's a very different game.
Can I call attention to Bryce's epic failure at trying to introduce The Contender to an audience and how he covered for it? Like, oh yeah, no, I was asked last minute in Anderson Cooper to go talk political games and fun things to do, and I was going to bring The Contender with me, but I didn't. But I mentioned Contender to the woman doing the makeup, and she said, oh, I love that game. It's great.
This was a friendly social board game night for me. Oh my goodness.
Wait, what happened? What happened?
I don't know.
He was saying that he was going to bring the contender, but
he didn't.
Very
clearly rolling downhill is what's happening.
Oh, I like that game.
No, I never. I said I should. I should have. This was not I'm not actually his street team. This was not.
No one's a street. No one. You get off the street. No. you deserve better.
No man is
a
street unto himself.
I was going to do this thing to help you out, but I didn't. But somebody, here's the thing, though. I got a compliment for you, though.
Oh, my
God. Yeah, there's that. Hey, I'm happy for anybody who comes anywhere near the game and gives it a shot. Unlike the Dice Tower podcast that totally took a crap on us without playing the game. And both of them admitted that they didn't play the game but said it was awful just by reading the rules.
I
hear that podcast is awful.
Did you reach out to them or how did that go? This is what after things should be, the politics of how you massage those wrinkles.
I got pretty angry.
Then I got pretty drunk.
I was trying real hard to be the shepherd. I took a few breaths. I wrote a series of tweets that were basically just saying, hey, look, like, I'm the creator of the game. It's kind of a bummer that you guys took a poop on us. Sorry, I was very kind of bummed to hear that. And I do think that the game mechanic is not just a... Because if you just read the cards as if it were Cards Against Humanity, it looks like a crap game. It looks like a really terrible game. It's not that game. You know, you kind of need to understand that it is different, which... I would think would be rewarded by a podcast dedicated to the field that somebody was trying to push, you know, the context of the game forward. But so I wrote a series of I thought very restrained tweets, and then I called my friend Brian Brushwood, who very oftentimes is we can use his release valves for rage. And in my hour of need, Brian said, hey, man, can I call you back? And then didn't call me back for 24 hours.
Oh, my phone was there, Justin, just to make Brian feel better. You could have called. You could have. Because I'm really good at that. I'm really good at returning those calls. Very good, actually.
Boy, I screwed up. And then I got drunk on stream and played Hearthstone.
Yeah, I mean, have I ever taken like more than maybe an hour to get back on something like that?
Never. Just lightning. Yeah.
I'm just saying, no, the fault's not. Brian's got kids, and I've got nothing. I was there for you, but I understand how this friendship works now. I know, you know, where you're going to go, where you go for this, and understand. I have to reframe some things here. I'm going to have to call up my buddy Brian, who probably will take my call, and talk this over with him.
Yeah. Look, those super mutants aren't going to punch themselves, so I'm just going to go retire to the Commonwealth for a little while. Sorry.
All right. Good night, everybody. What a sour, what a misstep of an ending of a night.
It's just a bunch of pals joshing with each other.
Good night, everybody.
You're not off the hook, Bryce.
Lamborghini, roll up in a blue bikini. Bitches on the beaches looking super cute and freaky. All my friends are princesses, we keep it whipped and creamy.